Yes, sir.
Can you see the slide? Okay. So today we'll discuss about pathology of important parasitic diseases. So far, I mean, these parasitic diseases are concerned, of course. You will have little bit difficulty in, identification of the parasites because you have not gone, the parasitic diseases in parasitology, right? So without, the knowledge of this parasitology, little bit, you will have difficulties, of course, but I'll try to make you understand the important pathological conditions or diseases or these changes caused by the different, these parasites, okay? So under these parasitic diseases, you will have different type of these parasites like these tapeworms, roundworms and all, right? Then this different type of these parasites. Those different types of these parasites and their properties are regarding their identification, the morphological changes and properties. Everything means we learn in details in parasitology. That much we cannot go for. This detail and telling all the details. Okay. So I'll just pick up important parasitic diseases and their pathological changes. Okay, the first one is about fasciolosis. Okay, this trematode known as fasciola. Okay, this species fasciola having two, this species fasciola hepatica and fasciola gigantica. They are also known as liver flukes. Okay, they are, some kind of this trematode, commonly known as liver flukes. And this kind of this infection in case of this animal, okay, when this liver flukes, they used to target the liver, that's why they are known as liver flukes. Okay, and the animal used to show hepatitis, cholecystitis, and jaundice, this icterus, as I am showing here. Okay. Just time of these flukes like this. And when last time in the practical class, I have shown some specimen of this very particular fasciolosis, right? So there means there's some gross specimen of the liver, bovine liver I have shown. Okay, so like this, the gross specimen, when you, this next section of the gross section of this liver affected by this fasciola and all, you will have, you can demonstrate the presence of these flukes, the cut section of the flukes like this on the liver section. Okay, and like this also you can see in the presence of these flukes in the liver, particularly in the this bile ducts and all this, right? They used to enter through the bile duct and the causing this cirrhosis later on. This in severe this conditions and all. Initially they used to cause hepatitis inflammatory reaction. And this cholecystitis also, and later on, they may lead to cirrhosis. Okay, so these are the this liver affected by this fasciola hepatica or fasciola gigantica. Two type of these species are there, and this one, this part of the liver is showing icterus, and this zone, this yellowish discoloration due to increased bilirubin and this retention in the this circulation. Right. And these are the cycle. These things means I will not go in details. We learn in this parasitology also. So cycle and all these things I will not go. I'll just try to show the pathological changes, the characteristic pathological changes caused by different parasitic diseases. And mostly it's such kind of this parasite, these liver flukes, they are present in the feces of the affected animal when it is excreted out and all. And they can germinate and form the this miracium. And the miracidium, the larval stage penetrates the body of the snails. Snails are the this intermediate host, and after several stages, they may this become Sercaria. And this part and this stage, they used to attach, remain and this attach in the plants, particularly which are grown in the this water and all. And that is the main source. Okay. And this form is also called as Metasercaria. And when it is ingested by the animal, okay, then means it will go through the this digestive system and reach to the intestines. From there, they may penetrate the intestinal wall and migrates towards the liver. And they used to go through the this bile ducts, gallbladder and all, and the liver, bile ducts and gallbladder will be affected, causing inflammatory reaction. Okay, so the affected animals used to show some signs and symptoms like this, very much this anemic condition, emaciation, jaundice, diarrhea, constipation, and very typically one and this typical this finding characteristic feature is that edematous swelling, edema in the lower parts of the body, particularly here in this submandibular and this region. Okay, see, this is very much, I mean, this characteristic for this type of this facialosis. And this very particular edematous swelling of the submandibular region of the affected cattle or and the other animals, it is mainly due to hypoalbuminemia, means the protein and this used to be very much destructed and down, I mean this, okay, the level of the and this protein in the circulation used to be very much, I mean this, decreased. So that leads to edematous fluid. As means you have learned already the causes of this, you know, I mean this edema and all these things, right? And this kind of this, I mean this hypoalbuminemia, so that will lead to, that will lead to edematous swelling of the lower parts, particularly of this lower, this submandibular region. So this is very much characteristic for this particular disease, facialosis. And so far the growth changes, as we have already this seen in the practical class also, I have shown you. So you may find some necrotic channels, I mean in the liver, and sometimes some abscess formation may be there. And particularly what in the previous slide, as the first slide, I have shown you that presence of this parasite, that means those adult flukes in the bile duct or sometimes in the gallbladder. When you make the growth section of the this liver, you can see the this flukes and this, or you can find it out when you conduct postmortem examination and all. And if you make section, so there will be infiltration of many inflammatory cells, like, you know, I mean this, in case of this parasitic diseases, parasitic infestation or infections and all. So most common predominant are, and these inflammatory cells are eosinophils. So along with this, you may have some lymphocytes and mononuclear, this macrophages, this macrophages. Okay, and finally, this type of this necrotic lesion or this lesion. So they may be encircled by fibrous connective tissue. That means fibrosis will be there. So that's why the liver parenchyma may show cirrhosis or fibrosis, or cirrhosis is also known as means we have learned in this systemic pathology also, right? And this diagnosis for this disease may be based on the clinical signs and symptoms, particularly when we are talking about a sign symptom means emaciation, this anemia, icterus, then most typically we know that submandibular region, this edema. Okay, then lesions about cirrhotic, this liver, and the liver is much enlarged, and the jaundice, I mean the yellowish discoloration may be there. And if you make section, then you can demonstrate the presence of this flukes and dolphin. Then you can go for fecal examination. From there, you can just demonstrate the presence of the this ova and the edge of this very particular flukes and all. And the liver and gallbladder examination, during the postmortem examination for the presence of this and this flukes, adult flukes, this fasciola. Okay, that is very much important. Then demonstration of this parasitic antigen can also be conducted in the feces, milk, or the serum of the affected animal collected from the affected animal by conducting this ELISA. Okay, so like this means some this photography, a microscopic this picture of this parasitic granuloma means you can come across. Okay, and finally it's just kind of this lesion with infiltration of many inflammatory cells, mostly of the eosinophils, used to be encircled by fibrous connective tissue, means that is parenchyma, this fibrosis, or what we call cirrhosis in liver, right? Then next is emphysematosis. So this type of this infection means they are known as empistomes or paraempistomes, right? And they are also known as rumen flukes or this conical flukes, and they are mostly observed in the warmer regions of the glove. Okay, and Most common British para and pistons of domestic animals are given here down here. I mean the different species of these para and pistons. Okay, so these are the main, this and according to their host and occurrence and all this I have given in this table. And such kind of this parasites, they also, this kind of this flukes also, I mean, have some intermediate host, like, I mean, these snails, like in case of this, you know, this Pestalozzi's snail are the, this intermediate host. And the affected animals, means they may suffer from severe arthritis, possibly, I mean, there's some necrotic and hemorrhagic lesions may be there in the, this intestine. And the clinical findings, I mean, signs and symptoms of this disease condition, epistomosis and all. So affected animals may show this loss of appetite, polydipsia, then this untryptiness and a very severe form of this diarrhea. And they may have some maxillary, this edema, as well as paleness of the visible mucous membrane. And the death of this affected animal usually occurs within 15 to 20 days after the first clinical sign symptom appear. And the mortality rate may be very high, especially particularly in case of the young cattle and sheep. And so far the older, these older animals, the adults are concerned, they may develop some resistance to this reinfection of this very particular, this empistome or parempistome, but they may continue to harbor numerous or mismatch many numbers of this adult flukes in their body, in the system, right? And so far the changes, pathological changes caused by this empistome or parempistomes are concerned, particularly the duodenum and abomasum may show very severe inflammatory reaction with hemorrhagic, that may be petechial pinpoint hemorrhagic lesions, right? And in less severe cases, when I mean this, that is about the very severe, this inflammatory case and the severe condition where duodenum and abomasum may show severe inflammatory and hemorrhagic type of this inflammatory reaction, right? In severe cases, this less severe cases where the mucosa may be corrugated, the intestinal mucosa I'm talking about, then with erosions and some petechial or petechial hemorrhage, pinpoint hemorrhagic lesions, and sometimes you may find this serous effusions. Okay, in varying degrees, I mean, a serious type of this fluid and the effusion. Okay, and then there may be also this oligocytemia and hypoalbuminemia, means in such cases also. Okay, then next is about ascariasis. This kind of these worms, I mean, they are mainly these round worms. Okay, this ascaries, and they are the parasites, I mean, this worm, round worm, these infestations of the animals, mainly caused by these ascaride worms and round worms known as ascaries. Okay, and most characteristic feature is that the affected animals used to suffer from diarrhea, jaundice, and obstruction of the bile duct, sometimes peritonitis, and obstruction of the intestinal lumen. So this is very common, I mean, this diarrhea and, this obstruction of the intestinal lumen. When the worm burden, I mean, this too much of this worm entangle each other. Okay, many worms, means they may block, they may obstruct the intestinal lumen even. That is very common. Okay, and there are many, these ascarids, like Ascaris lumbicoides in case of the Ascaris lumbici, Toxocara canis, Toxocara cati, this Noscaris and this Betulorum, then this Parascaris, this Ikorum in case of these horses. So like this, there are some ascaridic worms and this commonly found in case of different species of this animal, right? And so far the pathogenesis of this concern and this worm and this round worms and this ascaridic, the eggs or the larvae, stage of this parasite round worm, they may be ingested through the contaminated feed or water, right? Then the larvae used to invade the intestines of this affected animals and susceptible animal, passing through the liver, they may spread towards the lungs, entering into the bronchi, then trachea, and again it may be swallowed to develop adult parasites in the intestinal lumen. So far in case of this cattle, the larvae may also reach to the fetus. I mean, when we are talking about gravid uterus, pregnant animals, okay, they may reach to the fetus through the prenatal or transmammary passage. Then the clinical sign symptoms of the animal means affected animal, mostly they may be suffering from diarrhea, high rise of the body temperature, constipation, and this jaundice. And one very particular I'm showing here, one of the this species of this Ascaris, that is Ascaris sum, most common roundworm of the pig. So this is a highly pathogenic parasite of the young pigs. And in just this infestation, Ascaris sum infestation, a significant this losses, to the swine industry. A great economic loss and significant losses may happen, means occur in the swine industry, mainly due to reduction in the growth rate, then stunting of the young pigs and liver contamination. Means here also one of the most common target and this organ is liver. Okay, there in the liver, very particular, this very typical lesions. Don't forget it in the exams also. Sometimes you may come across in the biopsy and all, like milk spots. We used to say when the larvae, of this parasite, this Ascaris sum, they are migrating towards the parenchyma and all, they used to cause degenerative changes of the liver parenchyma. And later on, they will subsequently, they will cause cirrhosis. Okay, so these cirrhotic lesions on the liver parenchyma used to be demonstrated, or this observed found is grayish white, milky white, and this spot on the liver like this, as I'm showing here. Okay, so many this white this spots, milky white spots. These are nothing but due to the this larvae, Ascaris sum, when they are migrating the liver towards the liver through liver, so they used to cause degenerative changes, necrosis, later on this liver cirrhosis. Okay, multiple, this multifocal, we can say, cirrhotic lesions. And that used to be shown as milky white spots, like this. So these very particular pathological growth, pathological changes are known as milk spots, and mainly responsible or caused by the, infection of by this roundworm, Ascaris sum. So far, in case of the lungs, the larvae may cause hemorrhagic lesions, and they may also cause pneumonia of the this lungs. So parasitic pneumonia or those type of this pneumonia this caused by parasites are known as verminous pneumonia. So verminous pneumonia means simply pneumonia caused by this parasite, but this Ascaris sum, when they are migrating towards the lungs through liver, right? So they may cause this verminous pneumonia, and the liver may also some hemorrhagic lesions. And in case of these young animals, they may, when their these lungs has been affected due to this pneumonia and all, they may show marked respiratory signs, some respiratory problem. That very particular respiratory problem or respiratory sign caused by this Ascaris sum in case of the young animals, young cattle and all. So that is known as thumbs. Okay, so here I'm just showing some photographs. See, within the this lumen of the intestine, so many these adult, roundworms, this Ascaris sum out there. So they may block the intestinal and this passage also lumen. Okay, like that also. Then after penetrating through the wall of this intestine going towards this liver, so they may cause liver degenerative and necrotic changes, ultimately cirrhotic lesions, multifocal cirrhotic lesions. So there means they will form milk spots, milky white spots due to the cirrhotic lesions and all. And in the gallbladder also, if they affect the gallbladder, damage on this cause severe inflammatory reaction called cystitis. Okay. Then growth changes, as we have already discussed, presence of the adult worms mostly means you may find in the intestinal lumen entangling each other and blocking or obstructing the intestinal passages. And when they are just migrating towards the liver, initially they will cause degenerative changes, then inflammation, hepatitis, then subcapsular capsular fibrosis. Okay, there, this kind of this lesion, mostly multifocal type of this fibrotic lesions used to be there. And This shown as milk white spots, okay, what we call milk spots, right? Then some granulomatous lesions, nodular lesions may be found in the kidneys, liver, lungs, myocardium, or I mean, sometimes even in lymph nodes. And the larvae of this roundworm and this Escherichia, they used to migrate in the abnormal host. Animals other than this, what is a main host, like, so the visceral larvae migrants means sometimes maybe they're in the human, means they may migrate. Okay, and microscopic changes are, you may have some caseous hepatitis with fibrosis when you make the section of those milk spots and all, right? Then eosinophilic enteritis may be there, and hemorrhagic lesions may be observed in case of the intestine as well as the lungs, right? Then finally, diagnosis, which can be based on the symptoms and the lesions. Then you can go for fecal examination for demonstration of the parasitic ova. Then the presence of this parasite can also be this demonstrated in the intestine during the postmortem examination. Yes, I have shown you the picture, right? And there's many adult parasites, roundworms, were there in the intestinal lumen, right? Then next is strongyloses. So mostly is one of the very common, I mean, this strongyloses in the equines. That's why it's equine strongyloidosis. Okay, so it is another this roundworm. Okay, the nematode means roundworm, parasitic disease of the equines, where means you may have the problem of verminous arthritis. Means this is simply arthritis, but associated with parasitic infestation. That's why verminous, the term verminous means parasitic. So verminous arthritis, then aneurysm may be there, and there may be formation of several thrombi, and the animal used to be very much anemic, and some intestinal infarction may be there, right? So men, this species are Strongyloides bulgaris and Strongyloides equinus. And so far the pathogenesis of the egg of the this parasite used to pass through the feces of the this affected animal. And the first cell larvae heads out and develop up to the third stage, and it may be ingested, which is the infected at this stage. Okay, larval, this infected larval stage. And that can be ingested through the contaminated feed and water by the susceptible host or animals. I mean, this equines I'm talking about. Then they may penetrate through the intestine, and it may molt in the submucosa of the intestine. Then it may reach the anterior mesenteric artery. Okay, and there itself, they may this form such kind of this aneurysm, several thrombi and all this, right? And after maturation, the adult parasites may return to the cecum, right? Then growth changes means the parasites may be present. I mean, you can show the presence of these parasites in the blood vessels, within the lumen of the blood vessels, or there may be some intestinal hemorrhages, and this aneurysm, thrombosis, or this parasitic embolus or embolism, okay, or arteritis, and the arteries, mesentery arteries and all this, and like, and they may also show inflammatory reaction. So these are some of the pictures, okay, thrombi, then and this cerebral thrombi, then presence of your, and this embolism type, then this, what is the presence of the parasite also may be there within the lumen of this parasite, vessels. Okay, and microscopically, if you make the section of the affected organ and tissue, so in case of the, this vessels, whenever you make this section of some organ, this try to see the this arteries and all these things, so they may show this inflammatory reaction with infiltration of many inflammatory cells like eosinophils mostly, then some mononuclear cells like lymphocytes. Okay, then there may be infarction, particularly in case of this intestines and all these things, right? Then proliferation of the intima as well as the endothelium of the blood vessels, and hemorrhagic lesions may be there. Then diagnosis may be based on the symptoms and the lesions, and you can go for demonstration of the parasites in the blood vessels, and even you can go for demonstration of the this eggs of this parasite ova, okay, parasitic ova in the fecal examination, or you can go for antihistopathological examination for demonstration of such kind of this inflammatory changes as well as presence of this, I mean, this worms, right? Then these are some of the some more picture of the this your and this thrombi formation and the aneurysm and all these things in the blood vessels, right? Then next is hemochromatosis. They are also known as Barber's pole worm. Okay, mostly one this species of this, I mean, that is known as Hemonchus contortus. Most economically, I mean, this what economically significant type of this worm and this parasite, particularly of the sheep and goats. Okay, and such kind of this, I mean, this disease condition. Okay, what we call this hemochromatosis. It is one of the common cause of death of all these species of particularly, I mean, the sheep and goats and all. And other text practitioner, I mean, when, I mean, we are talking about the clinical signs and symptoms and all. So that may also, I mean, this very, I mean, this, what is it is, I mean, when you open the abomasum particularly, means mostly they used to target, they used to, I mean, this affected this abomasum and all. And get this sheep and goats, right? And they may show, I mean, this some this paleness and this pale color because of the abomasum, which may have scanty red brown content as I'm showing here. Okay, and tangling of the worms, this very particular worms entangling each other, means so many these worms, see, so many worms. So this kind of these changes when you conduct postmortem examination means you may come across particularly in the abomasum. Okay, and life cycle means I will not this show you. I mean this I will skip it. Means these things means you learn in detail. So far pathology it is not that much important. Okay, coming to clinical findings of this hemochromatosis. This is important. So far examination is also concerned. So the most common, I mean, this clinical finding of this hemochromatosis is that the animal may fail to thrive and may show weight loss, severe weight loss means. And when the worm burden is too much, okay, means so many worms, many numbers of these worms are there, burden is too much increase and all. Or more severe sign in such cases is that the animal will be suffering from severe anemia, hypoproteinemia, submandibular edema. That's why when you see the on this submandibular region, the edematous swelling like this. Okay, so this very particular condition is known as bottle jaw. Okay, this is mainly due to hypoproteinemia. Okay, leading to submandibular edema here in this submandibular region. So this very particular sign, it is also termed as known as bottle jaw. Okay, this is important, this terminology, bottom jaw, right? And the animals are very weak and they may collapse later on and this in the later stage. And unlike other, I'm this, your, I'm this GI tract or the gastrointestinal nematodes or roundworms, it doesn't usually cause diarrhea. I mean, diarrhea is not a common feature so far this hemochromatosis is concerned. But due to non-specific signs or lack of this diarrhea, this disease hemochromatosis is very much often undiagnosed until the death of the affected animals. Means diarrhea is not a common feature, it's not a common sign. That's why means you may miss that misdiagnosis, it is not suffering from such kind. Only thing is the sign, like, I mean, you may have the problem of some mandibular region, what we call bottle jaw, and emaciating condition, weight loss and all this, right? But diarrhea is not there. So most commonly means many of the cases used to remain undiagnosed when until and unless the animal die, right? But when you conduct postmortem examination, I mean, then you can this demonstrate the presence of worms, so many worms there in the, this abomasum and all. So when mortality and death is concerned, death can occur all of a sudden. Okay, even though course of the infection may have been prolonged, but the animal used to die all of a sudden. And the clinical pathological findings, okay, I mean this anemia, hypoproteinemia, and eosinophilia, that means blood picture, I mean this examination clinically. So that is very much important for this. I mean, from them means you can suspect. Otherwise, bottle Joe, of course, one sign is there. Otherwise, you may miss diagnosis. No diarrhea is there in this case. And so far the gross pathology is concerned, there may be marked pallor and of the visible mucous membrane and the internal tissues of the affected animal. And the very characteristic gross lesion is subcutaneous edema. Most strikingly, and the submandibular part, what we call this bottle jaw, as I have shown you the picture. And this kind of this edema is mainly concentrated. The reason that this part is the most dependent of the grazing animals. Okay, so this is most commonly. Other than this, there may be this edematous fluid accumulation in different these body cavities and all. That's why you may have the problem of hydrothorax, hydropericardium, as well as this ascites, as other this subsequent or sequelae of hyperproteinemia. So mainly because of this hyperproteinemia, so edematous swelling, edema of different parts, okay, of the, I mean, this body, this cavities and all this may come over. And the lymph nodes may be draining out the this abomasum may double in weight within the 5 days of this infection. And when you are conducting the postmortem examination, mostly the abomasum may have some dark brown, red colors, dark red brown colors, with multifocal mucosal hemorrhagic lesions and presence of this very particular worm, Hemuncus contortus, the adult worms may be present or there in the domain of the abomasum. And in case of the freshly dead animal, suddenly I'm dead and freshly conducting the postmortem examination and all, so the worms, they may remain even this alive. Okay, and if the animal has been recently treated with these antibiotics and all, so worm may not be on this form. I mean, suppose the animal has been treated with some broad spectrum antibiotics, antibiotics and all these things, right? So in those cases, while you conduct a postmortem examination and all, then you may not just find the presence of this worm. Okay, I mean, because of this already treated with this antibiotics. But the adult worms is approximately, when the size is concerned morphologically structured, 2 centimeters long, when the and this female is characteristic having barber pole appearance due to red color of the blood filled digestive tract against the wide reproductive tract. That is the morphological structure of this very particular worm, right? Then next is another important this disease, parasitic disease, that is known as esophagostomasis. And very characteristic lesion caused by this parasite and this esophagostomum. Okay, that is known as pimply gut. That is nothing but this whitish, grayish, white nodular lesion of, this very small size. Okay, from a pinhead to a pea size, that must, as I'm showing here, this kind of this nodular lesions. Okay, sometimes grayish white, maybe in color, like, okay, little bit darker also maybe. So this kind of this nodular lesions, as you know, pimples, in human, like this, you know, and there are, boys and girls having pimples on the face and all these things. So it is looking like pimple. That's why, these lesions, mostly in these affected animals, caused by this esophagostoma radiatum, this columbinum, according to different species of this animal, like cattle, sheep, and swine, different species are of this esophagostomum are there, right? So this very particular small nodular lesion, so that used to be formed in the intestinal tract, intestinal mucosa. Wow, okay. So that looks like pimples. That's why it is known as pimply gut. Means the gut or the intestine is showing pimple-like nodular lesions. So this is very much important. So far, examination is also concerned. What is pimply gut or the pill in the blanks or sometimes definition and all these things, right? Then these are some of more, of these pimply guts. Then next is spirocercosis, another round worm. Okay, in this case, it is a very common, this common roundworm of the, this dogs, commonly known as esophageal worm. Okay. And mostly found, this remain attached to the esophageal wall of the, this dogs. Okay. And the animal means used to show, mainly characterized by vomition, esophageal obstruction, and presence of tumor-like nodules in the aortic wall of the affected dogs. And the main species of this is Spirocercal UPI, commonly known as esophageal worm. Okay, and coming to pathogenesis, the eggs of these worms, I mean this, the parasitic ova, they used to be released in the feces of the affected animal, and they are taken up by the beetles. Okay, come in check, I mean these beetles. Then it may hatch to produce the larval stage, larvae. And this larvae used to, penetrate, after this taking up with the, contaminated food and water and all these things, like it is ingested, for example. Then the larvae used to penetrate the stomach and the intestine or the intestinal wall of the affected animal. Following the course of these arteries, migrating through the tunica adventitia and the, this media. This mostly they used to affect the these arteries, many arteries, after penetrating through the stomach and the intestinal walls and all. Okay, and the larvae then reached to the wall of the main and this artery, big artery, aorta, and sometimes localizes in the adventitia of this aorta in the upper thoracic portion of the affected animal. From there, it can migrate towards the adjacent organ, what is there in the just towards the nearby esophagus. There, they used to go penetrating into the wall of this esophagus, and they used to develop some cystic nodule, this nodular lesion there in the parasitic, esophageal wall. So because of that, nodular lesion, of course, and some obstruction in the passage of this esophagus used to be there, right? So there are, and these are some of the, these pictures, of course, showing, the nodular lesions and presence of those warm Spirocercal UPI in the esophageal walls remain attaching like this. Okay, and the characteristic signs that the animal may show omission, esophageal obstruction, and sudden death. Okay, and when you conduct postmortem examination and all, tumor-like nodules in the aorta, as well as the esophageal wall nearby the, heart, okay, that part of the esophagus nearing to the heart, okay, and there may be formation of aneurysm in this very particular aorta, or there may be hemorrhages, some hemorrhagic lesions also may be there in this aorta due to this aneurysm, and sometimes this kind of this nodular lesions. Okay, fibrous nodular lesions and all that may also present in the stomach as well as lungs, but that is not very common, rarely it may happen. And when you conduct postmortem examination, the worm may be demonstrated in the section of the arteries, particularly in the tunica, this adventitia, or sometimes the media of the aorta. Okay, when you make the section of this aorta, then there may be leukocytic infiltration. And necrotic tract also may be present in the aorta. Then finally, you can just go for this diagnosis of this basing on the clinical signs and symptoms and lesions. Then you can go demonstration of this organism in the fecal examination of the affected animal, feces. Then presence of this parasitic, these nodules in the esophagus and the aorta. Okay. And like this, you can also just conducting postmortem, and you can demonstrate the adult worms in the remain attaching to the aorta. This esophageal wall, or sometimes in the aorta and all. Okay, so that those things are important. So these are some more these pictures of this spirosarcosis, like this. See presence of this worm within the lumen or remain attached, leading to formation of some fibrous nodule on the this esophageal wall like this. Okay, so that is about spirosarcosis. Then next is about filariasis, and there are some filariates. Okay, filariasis is a parasitic disease. Filariasis type of a group of these diseases. So usually infectious type of just tropical disease in the tropical region. Okay. Mainly caused by thread-like nematodes, some roundworms, okay. And this kind of this roundworm may be belonging to the subfamily of the Filariidae, and also known as filariae. And this kind of these small round ones. They are transmitted from the horse to horse through the blood feeding MGS arthropods, like MGS black flies, as well as these mosquitoes, when they are sucking this blood from the affected person or the MGS animals. Like, so from there, MGS suck the blood, which contains the filarates, I mean, this kind of this small round ones, right? And there are many in this, this species of this, and out of that, this kind of these diseases can be divided into three groups according to the needs within the body they occupy. I mean, when we are talking about this type of this filariasis and all. So one may be, which system or which part of the body systems are affected, by this filariasis or not, right? So there may be, this lymphatic filariasis, there may be subcutaneous filariasis, or sometimes even it may be serous cavity filariasis. So three types of this filariasis you can go through. And the first one about the lymphatic filariasis. Okay, so this is mainly caused by this filaria known as Wuchereria bancrofti, or sometimes Brugia malaria, and then Brugia timori and all. And these worms, what happened is that this filariasis, they used to occupy the lymphatic system, means they used to remain present in the or going through the this lymphatic system, then affecting our the lymph nodes. And in chronic cases, this kind of these worms, they may cause this disease known as elephantiasis. This is the this very particular sign. Okay, means this is highly zoonotic, and those affected humans, they may suffer from such kind of this condition. So this is due to the edematous swelling of the lower limbs. Okay, looking like the elephant leg, and this just like the leg of an elephant. Okay, so that's why this is termed as elephantiasis. Okay, or incorrectly, there's some books and all these things, you may come across as elephantitis, but that is not the correct one. Okay, so elephantiasis, this is the actual And some microfilary, okay, the larval stage microfilary, they are present in those affected animals when you collect the sample, blood sample and all, and you can demonstrate the presence of this microfilary in the blood smears like this, as I'm showing here. Okay, if you enlarge, and then you can see like this. So this is highly diagnostic, and the human suffering from this, they will show such kind of this, sign. This elephant like this leg due to severe edema of the lower limbs and all, right? So this is known as elephantiasis, and mainly the sign of, this characteristic sign of this lymphatic filariasis. Then next is subcutaneous type of this filariasis. So mainly caused by lower, and this also known as eye worm. Okay. Like this Mansonella, then this Onchocerca, right? And these worms mainly occupying this subcutaneous layer of the skin and in the fat layer, particularly when we are talking about. And such kind of this filariasis and this disease condition, so they may lead to blindness of the affected animal. This human, this is zoonotic one. But this, that is commonly known as river blindness. Okay, then when we are talking about the serous cavity filariasis, so mainly caused by this Mansonella and species of this Mansonella, two species mainly, they are this very common, Mansonella persistens and Mansonella ozadi. Okay, they used to occupy the serous cavity of the abdomen, means in the abdominal cavity. And so far the animals are concerned, just in human cases and all, means it's highly zoonotic and all. And in case of this animal, when we are talking about the different domesticated animals like cattle, sheep, and dogs and all. Okay, so filariasis may be having different type of this disease condition. So in cattle, verminous type of this hemorrhagic dermatitis, it is very common. This mainly due to this parafilaria bobicola. Okay. And in such conditions, this losing the leather condition of this affected animal, and I mean, they may also, and this this is also responsible for, I mean, this this blindness in case of the human, that is what we call, and to talk about the liver blindness, this reasonably that kind of this disease condition. Okay, and I mean, this some stenofilaria, this asamensis, and other type of this, I mean, this filariates also cause different diseases in Asia, in cattle, as well as and the zebu cattle. Okay, and in case of these horses, one very particular disease condition known as summer bleeding, which is nothing but a hemorrhagic subcutaneous, where, I mean, you may have, I mean, this demonstrate the presence of this hemorrhagic subcutaneous nodular lesion, particularly in the head, as well as the upper forelimbs, and caused by parafilaria, this multiple sclerosis, and mostly found in case of the North Africa, Southern and Eastern Europe, Asia, and sometimes South America. Then in case of these dogs, and there's one very common, and this filarial, this species known as Dirofilaria imitis, and most commonly it is known as heartworm. Okay, so it is causing heart filariasis. So this is another problem, I mean, in case of this dog, other than your spirosarcosis, and most commonly also here in the, I mean, this Mizoram state and the nearby, I mean, this you know, I mean, this northern states also, you may come across this kind of this in a roundworm infestation in the dog, means heartworm infestation or dirofilariasis. Okay, and this kind of this disease, as I have already mentioned, you that caused by Dirofilaria imitis and commonly known as heartworm. And the affected animals, I mean, those dogs, they may show severe coughing, dyspnea, tachypnea, exercise intolerance, and loss of body condition, and finally, skin cough, okay, and die, right? And in severe cases, some pulmonary vessels may show rupture, leading to hemoptysis and epistaxis, I mean, blood vomiting, and this bleeding from the nostril and all the epistaxis state. And when you conduct postmortem examination, you can demonstrate the presence of the adult worms like this. Okay, adult worms apparently in the pulmonary artery of the heart and sometimes was at the right side of the heart, right ventricle. So you can demonstrate right auricle as well as this ventricle, means you can present show the presence of this adult, this worms, what we call this Dirofilaria imitis or heartworm, right? And there may be formation of pulmonary thromboembolism in the pulmonary artery and or towards the lungs, okay, or some hemorrhagic lesions also may develop. And if right-sided heart and this congestive heart failure occurs, okay, and those animals, they may suffer from this this right-sided congestive heart failure if it was present during the life, I mean, of the animal and all, then there will be automatically this enlargement of the liver, this hepatomegaly, and some hepatic congestion, maybe, I mean, this what we call, I mean, this nutmeg liver. Okay, so that kind of this lesion you may come across. Then next is ankylostomiasis. They are commonly known as hookworms. Okay, and this kind of this this parasite roundworm, I mean, the main characteristic feature is that those affected these animals, as well as, I mean, the domestic animals and all. So that may show dermatitis, creeping eruptions. I mean, one kind of this dermatitis, skin lesion. Okay. And with some eruption, this erupting, these lesions and all, very typical. Creeping, I mean, this, tortured manner of the and this skin and these lesions is also. And they may be showing the animal, or this may be very much anemic, they may suffer from diarrhea and progressive emaciation, slowly. Progressive emaciation means slowly, slowly. I mean, they will go on emaciating, I mean, this very weak and emaciating this condition. And there are so many this species like ankylostoma caninum in dog, then bunostomum, this phlebotomum in case of the cattle, then bunostomum and this trigocephalum in case of sheep and goat, and in global cephalus, this urocephalitis in case of pig. And so far the pathogenesis is concerned, this kind of this parasitic ova or the eggs used to be released in the feces of the affected animal that may hatch into the infected larvae stage and may remain present in the soil and all. So there may this effect or attack the skin, I mean, of the this horse, okay, they can penetrate through the skin. I mean, when they are just wandering or going to those and these areas where the this larvae are present on the infected larvae stage, or through ingestion of the contaminated, I mean, this feed and water with this infected larvae and all. Then the larvae migrates towards the lungs. And finally, they may reach to the intestine through the coughing or through the cough if it is swallowed in. I mean, when the animal is animal's lungs is affected. And one very common sign is that the animal will go on severe and is coughing. Then cough will be coming out. Okay. If it is not cough out totally outside, I mean, then. So it may be swallowed in, swallowing out the, I mean, this cough. Then it may go into the intestine. This way, it may reach to the intestine. So from there, I mean, they may migrate, penetrating and this through the intestinal wall and going to the intestine. This circulation, or then they may reach to the this placenta. When we are talking about the gravid and this and this uterus or this pregnant animals and all, they may penetrate placenta, affecting the fetus. Okay. And they may also appear in the milk to infect the suckling neonates. That means they may go into the, this other, affecting the milk and all. So when the newborn animals are sucking the milk from the mother and all, that may also get this infection that way also, right? So this is a picture showing the cycle of this ankylostomiasis. And the main clinical signs, symptoms of this ankylostomiasis is that dermatitis with very itching sensation of the skin, creeping type of this dermatitis. Okay, creeping and this eruption dermatitis will be there. And coughing, the animal will be this showing this coughing, anemia, then melena. I mean, this is very common. I mean, this presence of the blood in the this feces, melena. Okay, like this. And the animal will go on losing their body weight slowly and slowly. Okay, progressive type of this weakness. Then gross changes means you may have the problem of this lobular pneumonia. Hemorrhagic lesions may be observed in the intestines and some fibrotic nodular lesions in the intestinal wall. And dermatitis and placentitis are very common, right? Then microscopically hemorrhagic lesions in the intestine, blunting and effusion of the villi of the intestine. And sometimes in chronic cases, you may have even fibrosis of the intestine and with leukocytic infiltration within the lungs as well as this intestine when you see under the microscope, right? So these are some more and this picture of different and this ankylostomiasis and their cycle and all. Then now coming to the tapeworm infections, the tapeworms, okay. Yeah, I don't know means whether you have seen any tapeworm or not. They are segmented and having, I mean, this many segments. Okay, I mean, this and it's just looking like a tape. That's why known as tapeworm. And you will learn in details, of course, different tapeworms and all this and their morphological structure and all this things, right? And in these cases, I mean, the main characteristic feature of the tapeworm infection and in these animals is that anemia will be there. And there will be hemorrhagic enteritis. Sometimes, I mean, it may not be hemorrhagic. Okay, according to the severity, different species involvement, I mean, this of the parasite is concerned, tapeworm is concerned. Little bit, I mean, this, fibrinous or catarrhal type of this enteritis also may be there. Some may show this hemorrhagic. And this very commonly, and this most commonly, abdominal pain, emulsion and diarrhea. These are very common, anemia and all. But enteritis may be of hemorrhagic or catarrhal or fibrinous. That depends upon the different species of this tapeworms, right? So I'm just listing down some of the common these tapeworms affecting different species of this animal like this. Okay, so these are the common these tapeworms. Okay, then this tapeworm infestation, it is also known as cystodiasis. Okay, cystodes means the tapeworms. They are also known as cystodes. And the disease caused by these cystodes or the parasitic ones also known as cystodiasis. Okay, and these adult parasites, when they are present in the intestinal tract and all, and this host animals and all, they used to suck blood they used to have some scholex, okay, and this head is known as scholex of the parasite. They used to remain attached to the parasitic this mucosa, and they used to suck blood from that and this intestinal wall and this mucosa and all. So they have so many suckers and hooks. Means, okay, I mean, you learn and these things, I mean, in details, the structure and all this, and also, I mean, so they used to suck blood. Then they will cause very much, I mean, this severe arthritis, hemorrhagic type of this arthritis due to loss of this blood by the suck and due to sucking by this parasite and all. So the animal will suffer from anemia. So that's why the parasitic sign symptom would be anemia plus blood mixed feces and diarrhea. And the animal will be showing emaciation, progressive weakness, and sometimes there may be jaundice, and most commonly this abdominal pain is very common. And the gross lesions may be hemorrhagic enteritis, catarrheal enteritis, pulmonary type of this enteritis. But in most cases, you will find the presence of the adult parasite in the intestine or their segment, like then blood mixed intestinal content and anemic musculature of this affected animal. The muscle, I mean, used to be very much anemic, right? And microscopically, means you may have, this hemosiderin pigments when you make the section of the liver and the spleen after the lysis of the RBCs, the heme portion, okay, hemosiderin, I mean, the pigments from after the lysis of the RBCs and all. So that may remain present in the liver as well as the spleen sections. Then there may be fatty degeneration of the brain tissue. And most commonly, this catarrheal or hemorrhagic enteritis. Okay, then diagnosis may be just based on clinical signs and symptoms and lesions. And you may go for fecal examination for the demonstration of presence of this parasitic segment, the worm segment and all. Or even means you can demonstrate the presence of this parasitic segment in the intestinal tract of the affected animal host, right? So, this cysticercosis, last time in the practical class, I hope, I mean, if you remember, I have shown you some picture also, and I have mentioned about my case also, I mean, regarding this neurocysticercosis, cysticercosis, what kind of this disease and all these things, right? So that is mainly due to some of the, this larval stage of this tapeworms, commonly, of the tinea species. And I have mentioned also in this practical class also like Tinea solium in case of this pig, Tinea sazanita in case of this pig. Beef, I mean in cattle. Then Tinea multiceps in case of this dog. These tapeworms, when they are liberating the this larval infective stage, they are, which are known as cysticercus. Cysticercus cellulosa as in case of the Tinea solium, then cysticercus bovis as in case of this Tinea sazanita, then cunerus cerebralis in case of the Tinea multiceps. Okay, so these are the infective larval stages of this tapeworm Tinea. Okay, different species. So by the this infective larval stages of these tapeworms, so they may go into different affecting different organs and tissues. Wherever they used to infect and they used to locate, they used to develop a cyst like bladder like this cyst, fluid filled and this bladder like cyst in the, these different organs and tissues. Of course, when they are affecting the intestinal tract, GI tract and in fact this the intestines and all these things, right? Then, of course, they have to go on and this maturing as the adult tapeworms and all. And they may suffer from chronic diarrhea. Otherwise, means when they are migrating towards different organs and tissues, even the vital organs like your liver, heart, liver, lungs, and all these things, right? And even, sometimes they may migrate towards the brain. So there they may develop, the formation of, cyst like bladder like this cyst, fluid-filled cyst used to be there. So that is very dangerous because of this, vital organs and the animal even may die because of this disease. So these are some of the, species of this Tinea and their final host, the larval stages, the intermediate host, and the location of the affected sites of the body. So please go through it. Yes, it means I have given three, and this important genea solium, genea sajanita, and genea this multi shapes. Okay, so those I mean these cycles and all these things, and these are about the and this different and the cycles of those genea species, genea solium, genea sajanita, and the other and this species and all. And in the practical class also, I have already mentioned about I mean so far the clinical signs and symptoms, and it is not that much and this what is the characteristic, but paralysis of the and this affected organ, I mean, like sometimes if it is in the tongue paralysis may be there, and if it is affecting the central nervous system, then convulsion, fits and all these things, right? And paralytic condition means maybe they are in the, and it is highly zoonotic also. If you, I mean, this human used to consume the infected meat, I mean, this measly pork in case of the genea solium infected, I mean, this one, then a measly beef in case of genea sajanita, the larval stage cystic circus bob is infected. So that way, human can contract the infection or even contaminated feed and water and the vegetables and all. Like, and then in case of the sheep, one disease, and I have shown you the sample also in the practical class about GEET, okay, sturdy or GEET, where, I mean, this blood-like cyst used to be remain present in the brain, at the base of the brain and all, right? So this kind of this changes, I mean, this cyst formation and all these things, so they may this show some changes commonly known as pressure atrophy due to the presence of this bladder-like cyst towards the adjoining tissue and organ. And this presence of this cyst having, I mean, this different size and all these things, maybe multiple or the solidity and this many, the singular, this cyst also maybe there in different organ and tissues, in muscle, maybe in the heart, liver, tongue, lungs, brain, and it means so many of these organs may be affected. Or when they are this affecting, I mean, this the intestinal tract and all, then only means they may this form of the parasite and may remain present out there in the this intestinal tract. And from there again, I mean, they may this excrete the this segment or the this eggs into outside the body and all, they may contaminate the soil or the vegetables and all. And again, it may be ingested by animal, that way and this it will maintain the cycle of this parasite, right? And when it is present, just some kind of infected larval stage in beef, measly beef, and in case of this pork, measly pork, as I'm showing here some of the pictures like this. Okay, if it is ingested, if not properly cooked, or this uncooked one or this fresh one and all this, right, then means people used to have the infection of this and suffer from this cystic sarcosis. So these are some more pictures of this cystic sarcosis on affecting different organs. Okay, and microscopically, when you make the dissection of the affected organs and all this, you can demonstrate the presence of the head portion and the hooks of the this parasite in the tissue sections surrounded by very fibrous connective tissue encapsulation, granulomatous type of this nodular lesion also which used to be there when you make the section, where the this cyst is formed, right? Then you will have such kind of presence of the worm and this section of the larval stage of the worm within the this lesion, then surrounded by fibrous connective tissue encapsulation with inflammatory cells here, mostly this eosinophils just around this like this. So this is the section of the this parasite larval stage, then encircled by many of this inflammatory cell and encapsulation like this. Okay. So this way means you may come across this disease about this. So these are some pictures about showing the sources. I mean, when people may contract this infection and suffer from this cystic sarcosis, like fast food, your burger and all these things, so many these, even momos and all these things. In the fast food, they don't cook properly. Like this, if it is uncooked meat, like your beef or this pork, then means if it is an infected one with this cystic sarcosis, right, then you may suffer from such kind of this disease, cystic sarcosis, right? So these are the pictures showing the cycle, how human used to get the infection, right? And as I have explained in the previous class also, like, and these are the pictures of the affected humans when you conduct on this CT scan or the this MRI and all these things. And this is the growth picture where multiple and this cysts used to be present in the brain like this. And if you conduct this CT scan or the MRI, you can this locate the portion sites where the this cyst formation where they're affecting the brain tissue and all this like this. Okay, and particularly when we are talking about this neurocystic affecting this brain, so the human, I mean, this suffering from this kind of this condition, I mean, as I have already explained also, so there may be feeling this nausea, even vomiting, headache, confusion type, blur vision, and this may be blur, then weakness, numbness, I mean this, and I mean, you may have the problem of seizure, and the stiffness, seizure, and the stiffening of your legs, this limbs, our hands, and all these things, and you got this convulsive pitch also maybe, and involvement of the other organ tissues of the body, like I'm this your I'm this skeletal muscles and all these things, that may also be there, right? So when they're affecting your eyes also, sometimes means you may have the problem of blurred vision and all these things, right? So this way, this is these are the important parasitic, and this is about that. And this in the preterite class also, I have already told about and shown you the this bladder cyst, black cyst in the brain, and the disease is known as Kuhner's cerebellaris infection, or commonly known as GIT or STERDI, caused by the larval stage of this tinea multiceps. That is commonly known as Kuhner's cerebellaris. Okay, and mainly the affected animals, sheep and goat, like and this cattle, like mostly it is very common in sheep, sometimes in goat also, like, and they may suffer from blindness. And a very typically one condition is that circling movement, they used to remain moving in circles, that is very typical. Other than that, they may suffer from this blindness. Now, so the blindness, muscular tremor, incoordination, excitability, and even this embryonic collapse in that. Okay, and sometimes some wild expression and this frenzied running and convulsion and moving in and this rotation round, like and circling movement in circles. And sometimes there may be deviation of the eye and head and the loss of function because of the affection of the brain, right? So these are some important, these are some more, this picture of that, this GIT or Kuhner's cerebellaris infection leading to formation of this cyst in the brain, okay, like this. And that very particular disease I have already shown you in the preterite class also. Okay, and a few, particular, this parasitic diseases are also there. So for today, actually means it is a little bit difficult to complete it. So I'll continue this parasitic disease in the next class again, and I will try to complete in the next class. Okay, trematodes and actually and some more on parasitic disease, which are also important so far your examination is also concerned, right? So I'll continue on this in the next class.